So I'll ask Nitin to give brief about what he's doing and the throw light on current status.
Anyway, thanks a lot, Prashant. Good morning all. And energy storage is a fairly exciting field. We started working on it almost two and a half years back. At that point in time, our assessment at that point in time was essentially what many of us have already talked about, the state of grid, the grid infrastructure in India, and how many of these policies that we are pushing more and more renewable energy, which is by nature is unpredictable, is going to create havocs within the grid infrastructure system. Since then, we are doing 2 megawatt scale projects, and possibly we are the only one who are doing megawatt scale projects at this time. The one wherein PGCIL, as part of their smart grid innovation and initiative, they want to see how energy storage can be integrated within grid to see whether it can stabilize the grid, essentially. So that's what they're trying to do. So whenever the frequency goes down below certain range, you'll have energy storage power going in to maintain the frequency regulation is one of the application that they are doing. The another megawatt scale is essentially into the microgrid segment that we are doing again at CEL. Now there the problem statement is that they have multiple sources, so grid, diesel generator, solar power, and various kind of loads. So can you create a scenario wherein while grid is there, there is certain application, and as West has already moved into time of day concept, possibly it's a matter of time when India also starts adopting that. I know through initiatives of Maharashtra government, there are some portions in Pune at least, there are some differential tariffs which are there. So so that's the use case that is being worked upon. The second major problem statement, and I think Shinde Saab also focused on that, we are moving more and more towards solar and wind, right? And solar is there when the sun is shining, right? So what happens during the night time? One of the critical challenges, I think one of his slides did talk about the amount of exhaust, like either CO or CO2 or NO2 or sulfur, which is coming out because of the thermal power generation. And solar PV module by nature is a fairly energy intensive process. So till you're able to get down to that level of value chain, where it, instead of using thermal energy or the unsafe, let's say the nuclear energy to generate the PV module, we may never be able to say that we are generating an energy which is truly renewable. So to get to that point, essentially what you're trying to do is peak shifting, right? So you're able to store energy and then use it at a time when the sun is not there, or similarly for the wind thing. So that's another application that we are working with some of the solar power developers. There is also a challenge because going back to the earlier point, you know, the quality of asset. I think some of us did talk about the quality of asset. Now we are seeing some old solar plants wherein the generation itself, they are losing substantial amount of generation. Now any developer IRR for a given project is essentially based on either the uptime or the amount of generation. So there are some solutions that we are trying to propose to them in terms of how energy storage can help them sequence their overall solar power evacuation. Same with the wind energy. The third and the most interesting application which is coming out is into the commercial and industrial segment. Now, what we are seeing is a diesel replacement, right? So at any point in time, a typical diesel power generated could cost anywhere from 18 to 22 or 25 rupees depending on the quality of diesel generator or the age of the generator. When you start looking at solar and then combined energy storage, we are reaching a point which is in range of 10 to 12 rupees depending on the cost of financing. So that kind of creates a easy migration for people who are using a lot of diesel or diesel generators. So there are multiple use cases which are coming in for the overall energy storage play. Another thing that I just want to point upon, and this is going from the earlier discussion, the other big segment of what we do at Raychem is also the distributed solar. Now, What we do is complete end-to-end, so right from your PV module all the way to your fasteners and bolts. So anything in between is something that we provide as a platform solution. Now, the end customer, and I think Niranjan talked about it, you know, everybody knows, and media is probably here to blame, that everybody knows about the cost of power. So when we used to go to a customer, initially they used to say, okay, because mera roof chota hai, I'll give you 30 paise on what Sprng energy quoted. So 2.97 plus 30 paise. So that's the kind of expectation that people have. Then 3 months later, we go again. They said, I am even more generous now. I'm going to give you 50 paise because Sprng energy went to 247. So that's the kind of you know, generosity that you see. But obviously, they don't look at the complete perspective, the kind of you know, subsidies and other things which are involved. Now, one of the critical challenges that I would also like to bring to the fore, and probably if Shinde Saab can help us do something, is I go back to the Lehman days, right? What was essentially happening? They were kind of bidding on an asset which by nature was not healthy, right? Are we getting into a similar situation? Because all the developer, the large developer, it becomes easy for a utility scale, because you're talking about 50, 100 or 250 kind of a megawatt plant. If you start going back, let's say 3 years, 5 years, and some of the people are touching upon, at this point in time, the game is about creating assets, right? You're creating assets. Are they by nature easily transferable by the quality of asset is a question. Now, would the same logic apply into distributed solar? I have my own doubts. So I think that's a critical aspect that we want to look at. And that's where, given some of the safeguard duties and other thing, for the health of the solar industry, we have initiated a campaign which is Chini Kam. What essentially it means that to avoid safeguard and, you know, many of the issues which are there, you have option of buying panels at the same rate, what we call as a Chini Kam campaign. So that's something that we are doing right now.
Yeah, I think let us not start with a negative note. There are a lot of good things also happening. So let us talk on good things now to conclude the matter, because at central level,
before moving ahead, I find myself as a in the panel being the person who has spoiled everyone's mood in the morning. But again, means everyone has the same question. Niranjan ji told, Yeshwant ji told, and Sushant told. Finally, Nitin also said that how this tariffs, the quality of projects, all come in the way. Now, just to start with the history of tariffs, we are in the industry where we saw the tariffs from 15 rupees going down to 7 rupees, and then right now sub 3 rupees. Now, the first reason which everyone knows is the cost of module. And again, there is a abusiveness that the EPC cost is not considered during the bidding of the projects. Just to give you background from where we come, is earlier I was with Solar Direct, so again there also we had similar type of abusive statements when we had quoted 7.49, which was again lowest tariff at that point of time. But when as a bidder or when as a solar project developer bids into such type of tariffs, you are just taking care of the EPC section, but we come with the background where we have to raise the funds, we have to close the debt, we have to take care of the foreign hedge also while importing modules, again get the impact of anti-dumping and such type of duties, GST impact. So there are n number of forces which are stopping to get these tariffs, but still everyone is getting into that. So basic question, again, the logic goes that are they sustainable? So I would honestly say that till the date, whatever lowest tariffs were there, those projects are running. They're running well. Also 7.49, our project, which was once when I was in Solar Direct, that is also running, generating good. The projects which were executed 5 years, 3 years down the line, those are being sold, those are in the market. Everyone knows that. And those assets are again being evaluated and being taken over, or mergers are happening at this point of time, checking the quality of the projects. So I would say that yes, tariffs have come down. It's not only the EPC component which is helping to bring in the tariffs down. And when you go to the economies of scale, means this such type of tariffs are only possible with bigger size projects. If someone asks you in rooftop, that's honestly, means I also come up from a background where was for some time into rooftop business. So it's very difficult to make them explain that rooftop, what size of rooftop is there. The project size is too small. And again, that size comes with n number of risk, especially regulatory and taxation perspective. So this is the lack of awareness which creates. So similar issue we have also faced when first time they just read in the newspaper. When newspaper says the power tariff lowest in the country. But with the background that government has come up with the solar park, a lot of risk is reduced with respect to land and grid evacuation. Earlier projects in land only, if you take 8 months, then there is hardly 3 months left out to execute the project. So there itself, the quality of the project goes down. That's the point where the quality of the project goes down, not because selection of the equipment, but the execution time which is left out with the EPC companies. So solar parks, if you see the solar parks, the grid evacuation, again, project developers have burned their hands because grid evacuation was not there. So that's why I raised that point also. So at the end of the day, I would just summarize that the tariffs which are quoted, yes, sometimes we also feel it. We are not able to win all the projects, honestly. Even when we are project developer, but we are not able to win. So the only point is the return expectations, because a lot of investment has flown in into the country. And overall, it is the competitive aggressiveness that has brought majorly the tariffs below certain level. Means we can sustain up to some level, but below certain level, this competition has created that environment.
Yeah, I think well said and done. I think the central government is very aggressive on going on renewables, because that is the need of the day today. We cannot afford to continue generation on thermal and fossil fuels, because everybody knows we don't want our next generation to go back on bicycles and bullock cart the way we are using fuels today. So there is no doubt that we have to go for renewables, but only the problem is that it's a lack of synergy. The central government has certain initiatives and certain budget made, and the state government say, what is there for me inside? So I am not going to travel along with you. The investor says, no, I want only this. Unfortunately, what has happened, because we know last 20 years we are struggling with wind, and now the solar has come, the people have become a little wiser going into the wind experience. And with the solar, they already started doing what wind has started after 10, 15 years. And they already started squeezing from all the sides possible. And that, I think that is not the correct way. Because I just to narrate one story everybody has heard. Everybody is seeing the elephant standing on the road. And the from which side you are seeing, you can narrate the elephant in that manner. Somebody is seeing only tail. He said, no, it's very small. Elephant is a such thin animal. Somebody seeing a trunk, he said, no, it is a little bigger. Somebody seeing on the side, no, it's a huge animal. We cannot cross that animal at all. So the person who is looking from which side it is, he is taking his own judgment, how to tackle the solar projects or the wind project. And the person who has already, the investors or the developers who are already in this field from so many years, they are finding ways. Because ultimately, when you have to tackle the lowest tariff, either you have to get a low finance cost available in the market, take it from outside, or squeeze EPC, or do it on the land, do it on lease basis, do it on rent basis, make agriculture, the farmers as a partners. So there are many ways. On the central front, they are also talking about one tariff across the nation. Therefore, they are talking about green corridor across the entire beltway. The entire India is being connected through one grid. Of course, that will take some time, but then you can have your units transferred from Kanyakumari to Kashmir, that is possible. Therefore, they are also planning to have a REMC, that is Renewable Energy Management Centers, where on a state level, the utilities or the state load dispatch center will take stock of entire wind, solar, and hydro, and all kinds of renewable energy available in the state. And that can be sold as per demand and supply to any other state. And state can do that. So that's the future. We have now, unfortunately, the entire discussion on the entire way it is going, it is never going on technical now, not on technology now. It is on commercial. Nobody is talking about whether it is a thin crystalline or a thin film or how you are going to perform your PV sales. Everybody talking about what is the tariff. Nobody is bothered about whether you are putting a GI nut bolts or you are using a stainless steel or a normal iron. Because that is going to happen. If you want to, if somebody quote 10 rupees, somebody will go at 5 rupees. They say, no, I have something which is hidden cost. I can take care of that. Instead of giving hot dip galvanized, I can give you normal iron bolts and save a lot of energy on that. So that's a kind of worry, because maybe after 5-10 years, we will have a dumping problem for the solar for parks. All the rooftops getting rusted and people will be, after that, it will be blaming that we have gone ahead with the solar because everybody was talking about solar. We've gone ahead. Now it is a skeleton which is lying on our roof. It is no more generating. So we as a stakeholders in the field, we have to take care of that. It should not happen that it will becoming like a stock market or a buying option for anything as a trading. You know, as a tech, we should also honor the technology which is behind it. It is a need of the day to day. We want to generate energy out of solar, and because today's sun available may not, is not available tomorrow, definitely. So today's sun, we have to take use of sun today. So instead of all stakeholders in the market, I honestly place to everyone that wherever it is going in the wrong direction, everybody's duty to stop it going in the negative direction. That all the problems will be tackled with how to tackle the lowest tariff, how to tackle the utilities. I think Shinde Sahab will also help us in that for putting it wherever required. Because main stakeholders in this the entire project is either investor, EPC player, bankers, and the DISCOM, the buyer. The DISCOM every time coming out with a new, say, imagination that, okay, from today I will not buy your energy. I will not sign your any PPA. I will not allow you open access. I will start new cross subsidy. I will start any additional open access because it is their survival. Today, if you see the condition of any DISCOM today, it is pathetic. They don't have money to pay to their salaries. So from their point of view, it is correct. They are working from their point of view. Investor is working from his point of view. No, I want depreciation. I want good rate for my power to be sold. Consumer says, no, I want cheaper power. So I don't know how you generate. You give me cheaper power. So everybody's right has his own place. That means operation is successful, but finally the patient is not getting life. That is what is happening. So all the person like Mr. Shinde as a government authority, I request from all of us to have this in mind going forward that it should not become a street market. You know, street market, if you go to Nagdevi Street or Narayanadu Street, you can get even the heavy imported bearing at damn cheap price. It should not happen that way. The solar market and the renewable energy market should not happen that way. We should honor the technologies going behind that and see that it is a sustaining. People are talking about 25 years of PPA, the agriculture pumps are happening in the, it's an open market, it's a weather, it should be weatherproof. Who can take the guarantee that it will work for next 10 years, 15 years, 25 years? Today we can go ahead, okay, 2 MW, you can go rural feeder. Radhagan Siddhi is gone ahead with 2.94, okay, 25 PPA signed. But is there somebody who is taking care that another 5 years that will work? Because they will be happy that, okay, we have catch hold of investor, we catch hold of project developer at 2.94, and for next 25 years, we can get energy at 2.94. And feed-in tariff is 7.85. So definitely, I'll choose to go ahead with a competitive tariff. I'll never sign. I know in Maharashtra that not a single PPA has been signed at feed-in tariff for solar. And everybody is struggling. If you are the investor, he says, you know, solar, I did a bigger mistake. I never should have gone for solar investment. Why this is coming? Because if you are looking for any development of the state, because that is required, whether we are talking about smart city, the solar rooftop policy, now next thing is coming up as a separating of wire and content. We are talking about separating of generation and distribution. So any like the in telecom sector, every user as a commercial consumer or any domestic consumer will have a right to choose his own supplier. And DISCOM can only give the wire wherever it's required. So are we ready to enter into that state? Because last month I heard our energy minister, central energy minister, already announced that next Lok Sabha bill, I'm going to put this amendment in Electricity Act and separation of wire and content. So if we are struggling with the one utility, how are we going to help us to have a multiple utility. Like today, telecom sector has gone, I can choose Vodafone or Airtel or Idea, anything without changing my number. Same thing is a future. Next 2 to 3 years, we will have keeping our consumer number same. I can choose whether it's a Reliance or a Tata or a MACDCL, a Mahajanko. I can buy power from anyone. I can generate myself. I can sell the extra energy to the market. Because the problem is that what is happening, the center is going ahead. We are talking about charging up with the solar, the electrical vehicles, the battery vehicles. And at the same time, we are struggling to have electricity in some of the rural area. So it's just such a big gap in India what we have. So to conclude that, I'll request Shinde Saab to have, you have something? Yeah.
Actually, regarding this tariff, what I feel is that, we also have another business in telecom sector. And you have seen in time period between, say, 2005 onwards to 2010 or 12, there were more than 10 telecom carriers that came up, like, you know, Videocon, and there were many, many carriers came into the game. And there was a blood war, just like what was happening in, what is happening in solar right now, it was happening in telecom tariff, telecom rates. And today you see the industry has consolidated. We come down probably to the level of 3 or 4 carriers, like Reliance Jio and Idea, Vodafone are merging, and Airtel, and maybe BSNL or 1 or 2 government-owned companies. I think that in next 1 or 2 years, I think something similar is going to happen in solar, that there will be a consolidation, and once the consolidation happens, then this blood war will stop, and the tariff also will stabilize. And I think the second reason why the tariffs are going down is, of course, as you rightly said, capital cost has come down. You know, like inverters, for example, were earlier, maybe 2-3 years back, they were maybe 30-35 lakhs per megawatt. Today they're available at, say, 20 lakhs. Module was available at 45-50 cents or 55 cents. Today, I mean, during the Barla bidding, I know that people were taking rates of 28 cents. So capital cost coming down, plus a lot of foreign funds, you know, pension funds coming over to India with the expectation of 10%, 12% returns. So all these things have, you know, come into play in reduction in tariff. It's not just, you know, the developers are bidding without knowing what they're bidding. Okay. So, but of course, there has to be a balance. And I think that in next 1.5-2 years, this balance will come in this industry. We don't have to get panicky about it. That's what I
think. Thank you, Mr. Ram. I think just to conclude, if some investors in the audience with this discussion, if they want to conclude, we'll conclude that. Any investor, so he should not get disheartened. There are many ways for him to invest today. And what is the to be done with the power? He can have either fight with the DISCOM to take a fit-in tariff. He can go with the competitive bidding. He can go for captive. He can go for group captive. He can store and dispatch whenever required. He can be ancillary services. Or as a whole, he can give it to, because ultimately it is serving to the nation. Creating a green power is helping the nation or helping the mankind. So the appeal that don't delay your investment if you are thinking of. Everybody is there. There are many options, but that is the power sector today. If you have seen last 1 year, being a trader, because Global Energy, being a licensed trader, I have sold the power in India at 12 rupees per unit, and I have also sold the power at 90 paisa per unit. Same power, without any change in the color, same electricity, same ions and cathodes and diodes, everything. Same kilowatt hour. So that is the energy sector today. So everybody in the sector should understand that power sector today is today. You cannot take decision for tomorrow based on today. So if you are taking today, just decide on today's terms and condition and go ahead. Because if you have seen some glory, because renewable energy certificate, if you have seen, I have seen people who I have helped with renewable energy certificate. People have sold power at 6 rupees and sold REC at 3 rupees 50 paisa. So 9 rupees 50 paisa per unit he has earned. So depending on that, somebody has thought of, and after 6 years, now he's thinking of investment. Now the REC is being sold at 1 rupee and the power is sold at 2 rupees. So he said, no, you told me it is a 950. Now it is at 3 rupees I am getting ultimate. But because the delay, he has earned, that is the in power, energy sector, that is the first thing which are too important, that what is today. Today it is possible, so do it today. Tomorrow there may be something else which is coming, some positives may also come. So with that, with the permission of people on dais, I'll conclude. And thanks once again for the organizers for a nice gathering and lovely morning. Have a good day.
Thank you very much, distinguished panelist on the dais. It was indeed very, very insightful from Shinde Shah to begin with, and all the panelists presented diverse views about policy, regulation, about utility scale bidding that is happening, the issue of anti-dumping duties and various issues. But definitely the future is bright and sunny, and we have a way forward to go. And definitely a big revolution comes with a lot of pains. The pains definitely currently is aggressive tariffs, anti-dumping duties, and various other things. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I request a big round of applause for this session. I'll take the privilege of requesting our session moderator, Mr. Prashant ji, to present small mementos to all the speakers on the dais, please.